Hello, my name is Jeff Pilgrim, class of 1981. I'm the Director of Alumni Relations here at Williston Northampton. I'd like to welcome everyone to the third induction ceremony of the Williston Northampton Athletic Hall of Fame. Yay! Right, yeah. The school has a long and storied athletic history. Each year there are many highly deserving candidates and fewer spaces available, so the task of selecting an induction class is daunting, and we never going to satisfy everyone with our selections. For each person selected, there are 5, 6, 7 or more who have ardent supporters but were unable to be chosen. I'm very grateful to my committee members for all their hard work. And I think that we'll all agree that those selected today have done Williston proud, and I, for one, can't wait to hear them speak. At this time, I thought we would build on something special we started last year to open the ceremonies. If Joshua Harper, our Director of Music, Ben Demrath, our Fine Art and Performing Arts Department Chair, and all former Hamster and Whittakers can join up us on stage, I'd like to have them officially open the ceremonies with a song from their concert earlier today. Thank you very much. Our first inductee this year, is Anthony Tony Lavelli, class of 1945. Tony is the second individual selected for induction under the Veterans Committee's category. I'd like to invite Doris Duff, Tony's sister, to the stage, please. After a stellar basketball career at Somerville High School, the admission office at Yale University suggested he attend Williston Academy for a postgraduate year. Tony proceeded to lead the 1944-45 boys basketball team to an undefeated 14-0 record, with their closest margin of victory being 4 points versus Loomis. Tony, using his patented hook shot, scored 307 of the team's 672 points, even though he and the rest of the starters often didn't play in the fourth quarter. In the spring, Tony picked up tennis. After graduating from Williston in 45, Tony attended Yale, a second team All-American selection in 1946 and 1948. Tony was named first team All-American in 1949 when he set the NCAA scoring record. Tony was drafted number 4 in the NBA draft in 1949 by the Boston Celtics. His love of music emerged here when he had it written into his contract that he would be paid an additional $125 per game to entertain the crowd at halftime by playing the accordion. With that clause, Tony pretty much created the halftime show of today. At the time, Tony was the highest paid player on the Celtics, earning $20,000, or the equivalent of $200,000 today. At the time, the Celtics were not very good. And Tony helped draw in the crowd being a local boy. After 1 year, Tony was traded to the New York Knicks. While there, he enrolled at Juilliard to continue his love of music. After 2 seasons with the Knicks, Tony quit basketball to take a music career full-time, a move he never regretted. In addition to being on the Ed Sullivan Show and touring with Danny Kaye, Tony also played the accordion in nightclubs and created a few albums. Tony's affiliation with basketball continued as he toured the world with the Harlem Globetrotters as their musical director while also playing for the opposing squad, which is now known as the Washington Generals. After a career in the music industry, Tony retired back to his hometown of Somerville before moving to New Hampshire to be closer to his sisters, Ginny and Doris. It is my pleasure to introduce Doris Duff, Tony's sister, and to present Anthony Tony Lavelli, class of 1945, for induction into the Williston Northampton Athletic Hall of Fame.
Good afternoon. I'm Doris Duff, 92-year-old sister of deceased Tony Lavelli. I am here with my sister, Ginny Lovett, her 3 children from New Hampshire, and many extended family members. This is not my first trip to Williston. I made several trips here when I was about 21 years old, back in 44, 45, with my parents from Somerville, Mass, in my old Nash Lafayette car to see most of the Williston basketball games. I'll begin by telling you how Tony got started with both the accordion and the basketball. In early grade school, Tony was already a good pianist. One time during a Saturday afternoon movie, at intermission, he saw a man come out and play the piano accordion. He was fascinated, and he asked our parents to buy him an accordion. Each day when Tony came home from school, he practiced his music lessons. It so happened that an elderly neighbor gave him a basketball that the neighbor did not want. My mother then said to my father, "This boy doesn't get enough exercise." So my father said, "Well, I'll build the basketball court for him in our grassy area of the backyard." Tony then practiced basketball diligently, not only alone, but with all his neighborhood friends. When in high school, Tony claimed that the accordion playing helped his basketball playing by strengthening his fingers. His coach called it fingertip control. Tony and his teammates walked the mile home from school, passing a large church. Tony told the teammates that they must go in the church and say prayers for the next game. This became a ritual for the team on their way home. Tony's leadership and influence encouraged these Somerville teammates to go on to college, and they all played on their university teams. Even one who was only 5'4" tall played on the Northeastern University basketball team. When Tony was asked which his most spectacular shot was, fans expected him to mention his hook shot or his one-hand overhead shot, but he told of the time when he was jostled to the floor and in a sitting crouch position And he said he just threw the ball and it hit the backboard and fell in. Well, the crowd gave him a standing ovation. After the game, he said to me, well, I had nothing to lose, so I threw it and I was just lucky. At Yale, Coach Hobson said that Tony never blew hot or cold like some other players. He was always consistent. An opposing coach told his team, the only way we can win this game is to keep Lavelli from getting the ball. Tony had the reputation of being a gentleman and he was very good looking. He was featured in many leading magazines and in one article titled, Look My One Hand, the article ended by saying, which twin has the Tony? Which was a popular commercial at the time. But basketball fans said, they are certain that Yale has the Tony. We are thrilled to be here today to receive this honor for our brother Tony Lavelli. We thank Williston Northampton Academy for this invitation to this very special ceremony. Thank you.
I would now like to turn the microphone over to our MC for the rest of the program. David Korkowski arrived on campus in 1999 and is our current Assistant Dean of Students and the head coach of the boys and girls swimming and diving teams. Known around campus as Coach K, you may have seen him in one of our video booths for reunion recently. Please welcome Dave Korkowski.
Thank you, Jeff. It's a privilege and an honor to be here at this event tonight. Our second inductee spent over 43 years at both Northampton School for Girls and Williston Northampton, where she coached a variety of sports, including soccer, field hockey, basketball, and softball, even going so far as to coach two sports in the same season. She currently holds the Williston Northampton career wins mark in softball with 85 wins. I would like to invite Sue Curry Barnett and her presenter, Reverend Mary Conant, class of 1975, to the stage.
I've been given the delightful task of introducing and summarizing the 40-plus year coaching career of a woman who actually worked six different varsity venues, tennis, soccer, field hockey, basketball, ice hockey, and softball. Yes, exactly, six careers. Susan Curry Barnett's coaching career spans two schools and generations of female athletes. In the early years, most girls coming out for a team had never even been introduced to the sport because there were no opportunities available for them to play in community-based leagues. Today, a ninth grader might have 5 or 6 years of experience playing a sport, and an upperclassman may already have a college scout nosing around. Susan began her career in 1967, 5 years before Little League was gender integrated, and Title IX, the federal civil rights law that prohibits sex discrimination in education, was passed. There are many female athletes in the audience today who remember the inequity of the early years. They were competing against other schools in their green and white smock gym uniform with no identifying numbers. There were no paid umpires for the softball games, and one had to head to the boys' side of the gymnasium for athletic injuries to be tended to. And many sitting here today stared down an inside rising fastball without the luxury of a batting helmet. But no matter the era or the playing conditions, because of Susan's ability to coach, more often than not, her athletes tumbled out of buses or ran across the footbridge to joyfully ring the victory bell. And because of her coaching ability, a number of those athletes across all the years went on to successful AIAW, and for those who don't know, that's the Association of Intercollegiate Athletics for Women, which precedes the NCAA for athletic careers in college. Susan's teams were consistent winners, and they were winners for many years. And why? One was her ability to teach sound fundamentals of the game. Two was her razor-sharp knowledge of the rule book and using that for her team's advantage. When she argued the interpretation of a call, I never saw her lose one of those arguments. Three was her ability to assign a task and then ask the athlete to do that job well for the overall success and welfare of the entire team. And four, we knew she always had our best interests at heart and she always had our respect. Recently in my basement storage area, I found a letter that she had written to the girls' varsity soccer team in October of 1974. Apparently, the week before, we had beaten Northfield Mount Hermon 7-0. The previous afternoon, we had trounced Wilbraham Munson 9-1. And here is some of Susan's measured assessment. Everyone had their good moments yesterday. Many played their best game in several years. I think play by substitutes was outstanding. We were able yesterday to play our game, and we played it well. And there should be considerable satisfaction in this. There certainly was satisfaction for me because I could see the result of thought with action. All the days of making the same comments over and over seemed to be coming together. But that is one game, and that is now behind us, and there are tough ones ahead. We have to play as well or better, and there are areas which still need work. And I have quite the list for Monday. When I asked Susan for her take on her coaching career, actually I asked her for her lifetime statistics. She simply said, I may not have kept a lot of records and statistics, but I always played to win. Getting the most out of each athlete not only won games for the two schools, but it built confidence, created winners, and set young women with great life skills on paths towards successful professional careers. A former Northampton School for Girls 3-year varsity athlete and 1-year Williston Northampton School athlete wrote Susan recently commenting, we were dedicated to our sports, we loved the games, and we came together to represent our schools, finding lifelong friendships along the way. That is my personal experience as well with Susan as my coach. I labored for her for 4 years and 12 seasons on field and court and diamond, stopping penalty kicks, driving the lane, and turning the double play. In addition, I have spent the next 40 years having her as my confidant, my mentor, and my friend. And I know for many women here today in the audience, they have been blessed by that same experience. Susan cared about us as athletes, and she cares about us as human beings. And it mattered very much to her that we turned those double plays. But it also matters that all is well in our work and in our families and for whom we have become today. And for that level of caring and loyalty, I, and I suspect for many present here, are profoundly grateful. Now, knowing her as well as I do, this is the moment in the entire day that she has been dreading the most. Standing up in front of a large group of people to receive accolades and then having to speak publicly. But whether she wants to or not, she's going to have to do it anyway. So please join me in congratulating Coach Susan Curry Barnett on her induction into the Williston Northampton School Athletic Hall of Fame.
One's worst nightmare, having to follow a preacher, especially for this aged out former physical ed teacher, a coach who dreaded awards assembly talks like I dreaded missed free throws and giving up walks. Thank you, Mary, for the history of girls and women's sports, and thanks for your generous comments ignoring my warts. Sort of. Something you learned that we all need to heed: being kind to each other helps us all to succeed. One piece of unfinished business from an earlier event honoring Couchy, as it translates to this event, to Williston Northampton Athletics, and to me personally. Thank you, Couchy and Janet, for three girls who at times made up 3/11 of the starting lineup of soccer teams and 1/3 of the starting lineup of softball teams. For the past 5 months, I have been in touch with dozens of alumni and have spent some time in the school archives, primarily in search of information for Mary. I kept nothing, not yearbooks, not scorebooks, not records. In all the responses I received, only two of you passed along information about records, and that information was limited. All of you passed along stories, memories of your playing days, and reflections on what you learned beyond skills and tactics. Some would say we failed Mary. We did, I guess. But you didn't fail me. Coaching for me was never about records. Did I coach to win? You bet I did. But winning always had a much broader scope than the final record. Winning was about learning and focus and giving one's best. It was about bouncing back from errors, physical and mental. Winning was about teamwork and supporting one another, especially when the coach was, not so gently, pointing out to a teammate what she might have done better. It was about doing what was best for the team, even when you didn't want to play the position the coach assigned. Oh well, life lessons. That you don't remember records makes me happy. 70 now. Oh well. A nod to some here today who have turned the tables a bit. I now work out weekly with a personal trainer. Keeping this old bod active is for me a no-brainer. The tables are turned now. Some workouts are hell. And now it's the trainers who are saying, oh well. As I look out into the audience, generations of women tell the story Mary spoke to of women's athletics. Some argue that those of you who played on teams at Northampton School for Girls, with only 2 afternoons a week of practice and 1 game day, can't compete with the true athletic experience or true athlete. I take issue with that and argue as well that some of you played two sports per season, with 4 days of practice and 2 game days like your male counterparts, and what alumnus can say he played 2 sports per season? Some of you deserve to be up here. In the first year of the merger, despite tunics and sometimes faculty officials, despite being transported to the Northampton School for Girls campus for basketball, girls' teams did well. One of the stories from that year is of the first Williston Northampton girls' soccer team, going through their season not just undefeated, but unscored upon. And not so coincidentally, Mary was the goalkeeper on that team, albeit by protest. Life lesson. I attended the first Williston Northampton Athletic Hall of Fame event 2 years ago, as one woman and eight men or men's teams were inducted. The ratio the following year was one woman to seven men or men's teams. I spoke with and heard from so many of you here today, women and men, regarding the inequity, and we shared our frustrations. Some of us spoke with members of the Hall Selection Committee. This year's 3-to-5 ratio speaks to progress. This is the catch. Bottom line, no one, female or male, will be inducted into the Hall of Fame if she is not nominated, and we women need to get more involved in nominating our teammates and players. I brought a stack of the nomination forms with me today, and I hope many of you I hope many of you will pick up a form to take with you. I have not done my part in this, but starting right now, I ask you to join me in getting involved. If we aren't involved, we shouldn't complain. My thanks to whoever took the time to nominate me, and thanks to the committee, but mostly my thanks to all of you who played on or managed teams I coached, who cheered on your friends and daughters and granddaughters. Those were occasionally frustrating, sometimes exhilarating, mostly fun, and always wonderful years. You made them all of that. This is so much about all of you. I cannot refrain from just one more rhyme, though it will cause me to run past my 4-minute time. If you wake up some morning feeling under a cloud, smile and remember, you make this coach proud. Thanks.
Congratulations, Sue. Unfortunately, I don't have any rhymes prepared myself this evening. Our next inductee was a star on the gridiron, in the pool, and on the track. An All-American swimmer in the 50 free, Chip helped set national prep school records in the medley relay, 200 free relay, and 400 free relay. In 1954, he was a member of the 400 free relay team that placed fourth at the AAU National Championships. For his efforts, Chip Ide was awarded with the Denman Trophy, named the best small college halfback in the nation as a senior at Williams College, and a Hall of Famer already as a member of the 1953 boys swimming team. I would like to welcome inductee Harlow Chip Ide, class of 1955, and his presenter, Joel Chavone, class of 1954, to the stage.
I was asked to make the presentation about one of the best football players of all time. And they told me it was Chip Ide. And I said, is that the best we can do, Chip, for a football player? They said, well, his real name is Harlow. I said, that doesn't work. Can't we have a name like Newt or something like that, something with a little more gusto to it? He said, well, his name is really Harlow Chittenden Ide. I said, I'm running out of names here. I got to figure out something. So I read his report, and it turns out the pro football teams who were scouting him were having the same sort of problem. They couldn't imagine drafting somebody named Chip, so they changed his name to Harold. And if you read the newspaper articles from that time, Harold Ide was a big prospect of the Giants, of the four or five teams. He never played, though. I think the reason is the name was the problem. I don't think that the New York Giants wanted a halfback player called Chip. So as a result of that, let me go back to Williston. I was class of 54, a year before him, and Chip Ide was a total pain in the neck. He could run faster, swim faster. Everything he did was terrific. And we were sitting there, us guys, trying to earn one letter, one possible letter in our senior year. He had already won 14, and was on his way to running 12, I guess, a record. So he was a pain to all of us, but at the same time, we idolized him, simply because he was a great athlete. At that time, being a good athlete was very important. So just to give you some glimpse of this, he played three sports. Now, nobody plays three sports nowadays because you have to practice each sport individually over the summer, everything else. He played three sports: football, swimming, and track. Now, we all know that football players can't swim. That's known throughout the United States. He was the last football player who knew how to swim. And I have no idea how that happened, but his record, his achievement, both in football and in track, and his swimming were extraordinary. He was All-American this, All-American that. I don't want to read it to you. Coach K was nice enough to take, so I don't have to think about that again. But here he is, coming back, and I want to know, why can't we get these people in the Hall of Fame when we're 50 years old? Why do we wait till we're all 70, Chip? What? I don't understand. It's not fair. Anyway, I'll tell you one brief story, and I'll turn it over to Chip. I was a captain of the tennis team. And I said to my friends, Chip is a terrific athlete, but thank God he can't play tennis. Friend said, look out the window. And there he was on the tennis court playing with all my friends on the tennis team. Not as well as I did, of course. All right, he played a lot better than I did. Putting the final nail in my coffin. So Chip, I just wanted you to know, after all these years, you're a pain in the neck. You really are. Here he is, the greatest athlete I think the school has ever had, both here and at Williams College. 12 letters at Williams, all sorts of here, accolades, All-American, drafted. I mean, it's unbelievable. It is scary, really. Mr. Harlow, Chittenden, Harold, Chip Ide.
You get a second one.
Well, they asked us to make some prepared comments so they could have them for their review afterward, and I'd much rather speak off the cuff, but since I've committed some thoughts to paper, I think I'll read them. Thanks to Jeff and the awards group for choosing me for this honor, and for Joel himself, a really good, well, one of the best, if not the best, four-string banjo players in the nation throughout his career, and a terrific entrepreneur who rescued me from a very boring bank job and the early 70s and set me on a career of turnarounds and entrepreneurship. I came to Williston for summer school, and I guess this was summer 52, and my father didn't think that because of my sports that I would apply myself in high school, and so I came to summer school, so I didn't want to skip a year, because I certainly didn't want to skip a year. And met there a few great role models, a couple of which were on the swimming team that was once ranked the fifth best in the nation among colleges. And that was just a wonderful experience to ride through that for the years I was here. I think lots about Henry Taylor, who was my English teacher. And he was also head of the Glee Club, or directed the Glee Club, and I was with the Glee Club. And Henry not only gave me the gift of gab that got me through lots of fundraising for troubled companies, and he picked two of us to join the Berkshire Festival chorus at Tanglewood, who trained in segments around the New England, and then all the finale at Tanglewood always used to be Beethoven's Ninth, which we sang in German, and that was a heck of a thrill, one of the biggest of my life. So I'm very grateful for Henry. In the Williston, they mentioned that we placed fourth in the nationals my senior year, 4x100 relay. And all those seasons, it left me 1 month to run track, and I wasn't quite so fast. But Williston prepared me well for college, where I was married for the last 2 years, and where my daughter Lynn, who was here, was born, and I've got some other family here. And I used to carry her under a limbo bar like a football. And she doesn't remember that, nor the milk punch parties we took her to. She's been a great daughter. But the athletics, you know, I don't even know how you can be proud of them, because they're simply a gift for God. For me, I didn't have to go shoot baskets. I was just born with quick twitch muscles and could run fast and swim fast. And all of it, thankfully, just washed over me. As I said to my kids today, well, it sort of got interesting after I was in my 60s. And my mother had kept a scrapbook. But that was quick twitch, fast reflexes. But for the life of the mind, Williston's gift to me, much more so than my college years. These were a beautiful, formative 3 years in my life, and I will cherish them. Thank you for this whole thing.
Congratulations again, Chip. And as I sat there listening to Joel and to Chip, it re-inspires me to go out and find more football-playing swimmers for the next year. I'll be looking hard. Our next inductee, led by Hall of Fame coach Ray Brown, class of 1955, and assistant coach Chris Edler, the 1986 girls basketball team posted an 18-3 record en route to capturing the school's first New England championship in girls basketball. The team featured three of the top 12 scorers in Williston Northampton girls basketball history and beat its opponents by an average of 18 points. I would like to ask Connie Wilson and Ray Brown to join us on stage.
I'm going to start by bringing up the team members, announcing them, so please join me up this way. Team members included seniors Mindy McLean Caracula, Christine Trinseri, Deborah Wiseman Kingman, and Lisa Watrova Devoy. Juniors Holly McBurney Kassane, Melissa Babiak, and Annie Woomer Potosik, and Penny Duda. And sophomores, Jennifer Hatch-Gubbins and Sue Kalina. Okay. This is a wonderful honor for all of us to be recognized with the Hall of Fame induction, and we congratulate all fellow inductees this afternoon. It's also an honor to go in as a team, and certainly to be the first girls team. This is the first time. This is the first time that all of us have been together. Some of us sporadically have had these little mini reunions over the years, but this is the first time we've all been together, and it's been so much fun to reconnect, to tell stories, dig up some memories from our Williston years, and certainly the run to the championship that year. So we thank Williston and the Hall of Fame committee for this wonderful opportunity. Playing for Ray Brown and Chris Edler, our assistant that season, was equal parts fun and hard work. And how could it not be when you get 11 girls together? Brownie demanded the most out of each of us, but he also supported us, encouraged us, and certainly cheered us on. He did all this, though, while we practiced free throws and more free throws. We ran suicides from end to end of the court, endlessly, it seems, and we reran and reran and reran the plays just to make sure we got it. But all of this was he kept us focused on the basics, and that was part of his winning recipe. Who knew it would end with a championship at the end of the year? We weren't always the tallest team, and we weren't always the fastest team, but we were a group of girls who came together as one team. We were well-balanced, with a strong bench. We had a lot of depth that year, and everyone had a role, from posting up to playmaking to strong defense and everything in between. Brownie instilled in us a never-give-up attitude, even when we might have been the underdog on occasion. But he believed in us, and we believed in each other, and we proudly brought a championship back to Williston. And we certainly know how elusive those titles can be. As we recall different memories from that year and from our team, Chris Trinseri reminded me of a Brownieism that she still thinks of today. She said, he used to say there are three parts to every story, or three sides to every story, yours, mine, and the truth. And as we went through the memory banks for this event, that is never more true. Thank goodness there are pictures and stats and maybe some VHS tapes that might actually set the record straight. Some of us, Mindy, remembered all of the plays. Flex, motion, stack, press, 54, 44, 34, 24. The rest of us? No, none of us could remember any of them. Some of us recalled specific moments in certain games. Others remembered our opponents, from the team of trees up at Northfield, to Kingswood, who hosted our KIT tournament, to Suffield, with a great rival and friendly coach in Waskey. Then there was the ringing of the victory bell, 18 times that season, a championship season, and truly a wonderful memory and a great tradition, and thrilled to hear that that tradition continues today. We all recalled late-night practices and bad unis, and we think today's teams don't have to fight for the gym time since there's a beautiful new athletic center, but we did have to fight for some gym time in the late practices. But all of us are thankful times have changed, and today's players don't have to learn how to stretch the unstretchable unis, and that was a trick passed down to us from the previous teams. Sue Kalina recalls the fast passes to Mindy and to Missy, whose long arms put the ball out of reach of the competition. Always. And Holly's inspirational, aggressive power pop-up shot with no backboard needed, sink it approach. Brownie coined the phrase for Annie's hands, meat hooks. And that's sort of emblematic of what he wanted all of us to do, as Jen Hatch recalled, to be hungry for it, get in there and grab a hold of that ball. And if we didn't, who can forget Brownie saying, son of a biscuit, as he paced the sidelines. And at times, that pacing might have stopped, and things maybe got a little quiet, and we'd look at the bench, and there was Brownie at the end of the bench, sitting by himself, sort of willing the clock to go faster. We got the message. But collectively, we all remembered really some wonderful fun times of our Williston years and certainly our basketball days. And while these memories may be filled with long bus rides, bad uniforms, and funny sayings, we also know the group of young players worked really hard and stayed focused on winning. We remember having the best fans and family in the stands, and we're so fortunate to have so many of them with us here today. Back in the day, they not only cheered us on, but occasionally they popped Mindy's shoulder back into place mid-game. Thanks, Dad, for that. To Ms. Robinson, Professora, you lived through just about every dribble, bucket, and free throw made and missed. Thank you, honorary teammate, for being there for us courtside and otherwise. And thanks to the players, Couchy, Clarkie, Laker, and so many more, and teams before us who inspired us. We hope the foundation we created back in 1986 inspired teams that followed, and maybe someday soon we'll welcome another championship title. We certainly know how elusive those titles can be. And in closing, today, you know, Williston wants to inspire students to live with purpose, passion, and integrity. We are immensely proud of our Williston years and our championship season. And as we stand here before you today, we can confidently say that Williston has inspired us as students, as players, as a team, and as champions. Thank you. Come on. You want to say anything? You want to say anything? That's it?
Well, who can top that? Wonderful talk, Connie. It was great. I just wanted to say that I was up here a couple of years ago, and I said that reason that I was here was that I had a lot of great athletes. Well, here are a bunch of them right now. So proud of you girls.
Our next honoree attended Williston for 2 years, played varsity basketball and baseball both years, and varsity soccer as a senior. Roger Walaszek was captain and MVP of the basketball team as a senior, earning all New England honors. At graduation, Roger was awarded the Denman Cup, as well as being elected to cum laude. Following Williston, Roger attended Columbia for his BA. While at Columbia undergrad, Roger played varsity basketball, earning honorable mention All-American status his senior year. Roger was drafted by the New York Knicks of the NBA and the New York Nets of the ABA in 1969. Roger opted to attend law school instead, where he earned his JD from Columbia School of Law in 1973. In 2006, Roger was voted into the New England Hall of Fame. I would like to invite Roger Walaszek, class of 1965, and 2013 Hall of Fame coach Rick Francis to the stage.
My first recollection of Roger Walaszek playing organized team basketball may have been as a member of an East Hampton JV team that played its contests in the basement of the old high school building on Park Street. Such contests often officiated by yours truly. It was after one of these games that Jim Soja, a classmate of Roger, politely asked me how one went about applying to Williston, whereupon I told him to walk 3 blocks down the street to the big white house, knock on the door, and ask for Mr. Shepherdson. That was the extent of my recruiting East Hampton High School student athletes, although I was later accused of much more. As it turned out, Jim and Roger, along with two other juniors, Jack Zabek and Skip Jaraki, did apply and were accepted. However, the results of placement tests taken in course showed that because the East Hampton High School curriculum was considerably below the level of what Williston students in the same grade were experiencing, it would be necessary for them to repeat the 11th grade, a decision which would have lasting benefits for them academically and athletically.
Then, as now, Williston students were required to participate in the mandatory athletic program each season of the year. And so our soccer, basketball, and baseball teams were very much improved with the addition of these four young men who were all good athletes. I don't believe that I ever saw Roger play soccer, but as a testament to his athleticism, I do recall seeing him hit a pair of towering home runs that landed in the far lacrosse field. Of greater significance were his accomplishments in basketball. A particular incident comes to mind. For those of us in attendance at the 1964 home game against Deerfield, the score was tied when time ran out with the visitors in possession of the ball at the Dodge Room end of the court. Deerfield argued that there should be two more seconds left on the clock, and the officials instructed the timekeeper, who happened to be Al Shaler, to put 2 seconds back on the clock. Roger was face guarding the out-of-bounds player, who wound up to throw the ball full court. The clock was started, the ball was thrown, Roger jumped and with one hand palmed the pass and laid it back over his shoulder into the basket for the victory, shocking everyone. As a teammate later commented, shaking hands with Roger would give you an idea as to how he managed to catch that ball. As a 2-year recipient of the Dale Lash Trophy, it was no surprise that Roger also won the Denman Bowl as the school's most outstanding athlete, and as a senior was named to the All-New England Prep School team in addition. He was an outstanding student who graduated cum laude, was accepted at the only college to which he applied, Columbia University, where he would receive further recognition for his basketball skills. This included periodically gaining all Ivy and all ECAC honors and being voted captain of his team, which included ex-Deerfield seven-footer Dave Newmark and forward Jimmy McMillan, who played with the Los Angeles Lakers for several years. Amongst his many significant honors, as we have heard, Roger was drafted by both the Knicks and the Nets, but wisely chose law school. One of my most vivid memories of Roger's basketball career took place in 1967, when Columbia won the Holiday Festival Tournament at Madison Square Garden, beating Wes Unseld and the Louisville Cardinals. Roger had given Marilyn and me his comp tickets, which were on the floor directly behind the team's bench, next to the entire Columbia student body, who had a cheer which started with a trumpet arpeggio and ended up with a shout of, "Walaszek!" Loud enough to be heard back in the borough of East Hampton, Massachusetts, with a small town boy makes good. Congratulations, Roger.
First thing I'd like to say is that both Coach Francis and Coach Brown always said I was a coachable athlete. Please talk to my wife and my daughters. I've been married to my wife for 43 years, and she still tells me she's trying to bring up the boy in our family. We had 2 daughters, as you might expect. But thank you, Coach, for that wonderful introduction. This is your 3rd presentation in 3 years, and you yourself have been inducted into the Williston Northampton Athletic Hall of Fame, a true testament to a well-respected educator, coach, and mentor. Being inducted into the Williston Northampton Athletic Hall of Fame is a great honor and a privilege, a reward that acknowledges youthful determination, exuberance, hard work, athletic skill, luck, and, as I've always espoused during my life, just being in the right place at the right time. 4 young students, as Coach has mentioned, student athletes from East Hampton High School, known as Townies to all Willies. I don't know if that still applies, but that's what we were called. Skip Turok and Jack Zabek, who are both here, Jim Soja and myself, made what at the time was a very controversial decision, especially to t- townspeople because we were essentially public property as athletes. But that decision was quite courageous when we look back, to leave such a successful public high school athletic environment to attend Williston Academy. What the primary reason for this decision was to prepare ourselves for the rigors and demands of a college education. We had no way of knowing that at the time, that decision would thrust us all into an unprecedented era, I believe, in Williston's athletic history during the period 1963 to 1965. At that point, beginning in 63 and 64, we had an undefeated football team coached by Rick Francis, a basketball team with a two-year record of 35-3, with four straight victories, by the way, over Deerfield Academy. And one of my best friends happens to be a guy named Bill Burns, who was on that Deerfield team, and he will never forgive me, nor forgive any of us for that occurrence. We also had a fantastic swimming team, anchored by my classmate and obviously inductee in this this award ceremony, Mr. Jim Edwards, who was a class gentleman and an exceptional swimmer. We had very good soccer, baseball, and lacrosse teams at that time as well. As we all know, basketball is a team sport. The honor bestowed upon me today is an individual honor, but I believe the honor belongs to my teammates, all great players in their own right, namely Jack Zabak and Skip Jaraki, my oldest teammates and friends. And I mean that literally and figuratively. We've known each other for a long time, and we are getting old. And others named Hedbring, Ryan, Esser, Hardenberg, O'Neill, Swanson, Durant, Rowe, just to name a few. I share this honor with all of these teammates of mine because you work so hard as a team and force me to be the best player I could possibly be, especially during all the countless hours of practice, which frankly I loved probably as much as I did games, and I think Coach can attest to that. In addition, this honor must be shared with Coach Francis and his wife Marilyn, who were very, very kind to me during my stay here, and with Coach Ray Brown and several others who mentored me, disciplined me when it was necessary, drove me physically and emotionally to be the best athlete and best person I could be, and taught me to be a responsible person on and off the court. With the formidable foundation I developed, or I should say was ingrained in me here at Williston Northampton, I was fortunate enough to continue my academic and athletic career at Columbia University. Again, I happened to be in the right place at the right time. Columbia had relatively good programs in the early 50s, but nothing before then. I had the privilege of being an integral part of a nationally ranked Ivy League basketball championship team coached by a guy named Jack Rowan, who was an NCAA Coach of the Year in 1967 and 68. Led by an All-American Jim McMillan, as Coach has mentioned, who played on LA with Chamberlain and several other players and won that championship. We won the Holiday Festival that year that Coach and his wife had attended, beating Louisville, St. John's, and West Virginia. And we were the third place finishers in the East Regional of the 1968 NCAA tournament. And of course, the highlight of my career, just for recognition, was being drafted by the New York Knicks and the New York Nets. At that time, starting salary was $12,500, so I thought it wise to decide on another career. So I chose law school literally my junior year and decided I've been given such an opportunity, first to attend Williston and then to attend a school like Columbia University, that may as well go to a professional school. And I was fortunate enough to be accepted. That was my destiny, and law has been my ultimate career. Finally, I would like to thank my family, my beautiful wife of 43 years, Anne Marie, who's, hi, hon. My two wonderful daughters, Emily and Walaszek Endres, who is here, class of 1999. My other daughter, Rebecca, who is class of 2010. You can see how much I respect and love Williston. They spent 6 years here each. My son-in-law, Andrew Endres, who is here, and our 15-week-old grandson, our very first, Liam Arthur Endres. And I'm told that he has long limbs, big hands, and big feet, so you might start thinking about recruiting now. Forget about King James and his son who's 12. I mean, you can look at Liam. He's the guy that you really want. And finally, all of my friends, for their lifelong and unwavering support of me throughout my life. I don't think I'd be where I am if it weren't for people who are interested in me. And I'd also like to say I'm very proud to be at this podium at the same time that one of my best friend's daughters, Missy Babiak, was inducted into the Hall of Fame. I've known her since she was, I hate to say it, very young. And also very proud to be part of this class. Thank you, Williston Northampton, for this distinguished honor, and congratulations to all of my fellow inductees and to all of these staff at Williston Northampton. Thank you.
Our next inductees were coached by longtime faculty member Bob Blanchette, the 1992 boys golf team, which went an amazing 15-1 in that season. Captained by Jeff Brunel and John Swarzynski, the team captured the prestigious Kingswood Invitational Tournament, with medalist Brunel leading the way with a 74. The team followed up with an Eastern Seaboard Championship, where they took home the title in the three-man division with a final score of 475. I would like to ask Jeff Brunel, class of 1992, to join us on the stage.
Hello, everyone. Thanks, Jeff. It's an honor to be here today. We'd like to congratulate all the inductees. We appreciate you taking time out of your reunion weekend to spend it with us for the induction ceremony. So with that, it's my pleasure to introduce the golf team of 1992. What I'd like to do is start with this tie as a symbol for Paul Burns, who planned on being with us here today. Paul had plans to come in. He now lives in Mount Pleasant, South Carolina. Unfortunately, Paul's mother is ill and at the BU Medical Center, so we wanted Paul to know that in spirit he's here with us today. We're thinking about his mother as he goes through this time, but he really wanted to be here with us. So let's see. Let's start with... I got my notes backed up here. Let's start with Chris Shields. Chris, come on up. So Chris now lives in the Berkshires. He has three children. He helps to run a family business. Chris and my relationship goes past Williston. We were actually roommates down in Central Florida. We played some professional golf together, some amateur golf together, had some success. It's quite possible that Chris is not the best golfer in his family. Lisa, I believe, is here today. She was 2 years ahead of me. There she is. She was 2 years ahead of me. And Lisa was really a mentor to me. Being younger, she really taught me a lot about high school golf, and we played some great matches together. And Chris and I have been friends ever since. So Greg Knight is here with us today. Greg lives in Pittsfield, Massachusetts. He's in the insurance business, where most good golfers go after our glory days are over, as I am as well. He's married with two girls. And Greg always had this calming force on our team. He had this wry smile. And you never could tell how Greg was playing, if it was good or bad, but he would just come in and kind of smile and hand you a scorecard, and it was usually a pretty good score. So, Dr. John Swazerski. Dr. Swazerski has a podiatry practice here in Western Massachusetts. He has four sons. God bless him. He's busy. He married his high school sweetheart, Sarah Griggs Swazerski, class of 93. John's role on the team was swagger and confidence. Our first 2 years were not very successful. We got beat very badly on a regular occasion. John never gave up hope. His attitude was, we can beat these guys, let's do it, let's go get these guys. And that kind of bled throughout our entire team. So I'd like to also call Bob Blanchett up to the stage, our coach. What can we say about Mr. Blanchett? I think he's done everything here but paint the walls and the buildings, and his French teacher, he's my French teacher. Obviously married with two sons, and Mr. Blanchett is expecting his first grandchild this summer, so very exciting times for him. Mr. Blanchett was always that calming force for us. He was always even keel. He was there with a thumbs up and a fist pump if you played well, and he was there with a pat on the back if you didn't play so well. He was just the glue that kept all of our personalities together. So this is the golf team of 1992 right here. I promised Jeff Pilgrim I would keep this to 90 minutes or under, so I'll do my best to keep it short for you guys today. But in all seriousness, I'm not going to tell you about the big draw that John Swazerski hit over an oak tree up at Crumpton Fox, or the three birdies that Chris Shield made at the KIT in 1992, or the 25-footer that Greg made in the pouring rain to beat Deerfield. There's a good reason for that. There's a very good reason for that. I don't know if any of that's true. All of this happened 23 years ago. That's when our experience was here. And we're going to save those for the cocktail party, because I think that's a good place for all those stories. So buyer beware, the stories get longer and longer as the years go on. But we'll save those for a little bit later. There was a popular show I'm sure a lot of you are familiar with called Married with Children. And Al, the husband, would always tell Peggy, the wife, that I once scored four touchdowns in high school football. And he looked at this moment as the pinnacle of his life and his career, and that things kind of spiraled downwards ever since. I'm here today to tell you that there are no Al Bundys up here. Represented on this stage in front of you, these people used their success at Williston in the classroom and on the golf course to springboard to better things. We have college and doctoral degrees. We have business owners. We have, in my opinion, tremendous fathers. We have youth coaches. And we have overall leaders in their respective communities. So I think we should all be proud of that. We would be remiss if we didn't thank the teachers and staff here at Williston. We truly do feel that our successes are your successes. So thank you very much for that. This is a special place for everyone. We know that. Williston's not a place to remember specific answers to specific questions. It's a place where teachers are required to challenge students, but students are also encouraged to challenge teachers. This is a place where we all learn to think independently, question norms, and push our limits. When we were at Williston, I'm going to date us guys a little bit here, apple was a food, a mouse was something you try to get out of your house, and the cloud was something that blocked the sun. We didn't have cell phones. We had to call someone, make a plan, pick a place, and be there at a certain time. That's all changed. Ask my 15-year-old. There was no Google. We had to traipse across the lawn to get to the library and look it up in a book. So things have changed a little bit. But everyone here knows that Williston is not a school. It's not a campus. It's not a collection of teachers and students. It's an experience. And it's a pretty impressive experience, if you ask me. All of our experiences were unique. And of course, math, science, and English were at the core of the curriculum. Williston provided many additional opportunities, a chance to be in the school play, a chance to take an out-of-the-box intercession class, a black-and-white photography class. How cheap. It's all digital now, but we used to develop film in your lab, so I remember that. And a French class. Parlez-vous français, Monsieur Blanchette? I remember. Un peu. Our education allowed us an opportunity to explore a whole host of subjects. Today, the golf team of 1992 is proud to add Sports Hall of Fame inductee to our Williston experience. And for that, we thank you very much. We hope everyone has a great reunion weekend, and we look forward to the festivities to follow. Thank you. One last thing. Dr. Swizerski would like to present Mr. Blanchett, and we have something for Couchy, a team gift for you, just to thank you for everything that you did for us.
I had not planned on saying anything, but I think it's only fair, given the fact that this is the best golf team that ever played at Williston, that you understand a little bit more about their record. They were 15-1. They lost their first match and then cruised the rest of the season. Then they went to the league tournament against the 100 best prep school golfers in New England, and they dominated that tournament. So they lived up to their 15-1 record, with Jeff being our medalist that day, the other guys right behind him. Then we went to Williamsburg, Virginia, and we played a four-day tournament down there against the best teams from North Carolina to Maine. And these kids were the champions of that tournament. And on the final day, you play for individual trophies. They'd already won the team trophy. All of the kids we brought there qualified by being in the top half of the field. And at the end of the last day of competition, when they played their best, they were all in the top quarter of this field, and these are the best young golfers on the East Coast. So to do that from a state that's got snow for 4 or 5 months a year and play against kids from North Carolina, the Virginia, the places where they're playing all year long and own their own golf courses, this truly was an amazing team. There, I'll be surprised if anybody can put together a group that's better than this. And as a coach, one thing I learned, when you have talent, they love their game, they love each other, they respect their opponents, just stay out of their way and enjoy the ride. Thanks, fellas.
Well, well-deserved congratulations to the 1992 golf team. And if what I heard about yesterday's clinic that they put on at Wyckoff is true, and from what I know from firsthand experience about Coach Blanchett, that's a group of guys who you want to stay out of a money match with on the golf course. Our next inductee. During his 2 years at Williston Academy, our next inductee was an All-American swimmer in 6 different events while establishing 10 national records. Twice voted New Hampshire Male Athlete of the Year, he set American records in the 110 freestyle, the 4x110 relay, and a world record in the 440-yard freestyle relay, where he was the anchor. His time in the 100 freestyle while swimming at an AAU-sanctioned event would still be a record at Williston today, 50 years later. I would like to invite Jim Edwards, class of 1965, and his former teammate and current trustee, Kevin Hoban, also class of 1965, to join us on the stage.
Good afternoon, everyone. Swimming, while a team sport, is truly an individual sport. there's no assists in swimming, and everything you do is against the clock. The stopwatch is the gauge. Everything that Jimmy has achieved through his career was registered on the clock, and it all becomes history. I want to reiterate some of his major achievements, but I want to tell you something about the person. You know, what is a person like who is this gifted? And Jim was really gifted. First off, if you think about the fact that he set 10 national prep school records, and he was here for 2 years, our seasons were 10 weeks long. So over the course of 20 weeks, he was averaging one national prep school record every other week. Think about that. Every other week, he was setting a national prep school record. And of course, the number of All-American awards that he won is 12, and he managed to do this in 6 different events. Jim was truly unique, and as a person, he was very approachable in the classroom, he was very approachable on campus, but in the swimming pool, he was all business. And he really set the tone for that team. And I remember when we were doing our repeats, which were grueling. Roger Walaszek said how much he enjoyed practice. I don't think any of us ever enjoyed practice. It was just terrible. And the worst thing was when you got in a lane next to Jim Edwards, because Jim was so fast that you could never get ahead of him. So as you'd push off from the wall, after about 6 or 7 strokes, you were hopelessly behind. And you have no idea how big of a wake he made. And if you were in the lane next to him, you got all of the backwash. It was truly a terrible experience to have to swim next to him, but an honor to swim with him. I think, Jim, as a former swimmer myself, and I can tell you this, that the thing that he is most proud of, is the fact that he was ranked number 5 in the world in the 100-meter freestyle, and number 6 in the world in the 200-meter freestyle. That's in the world. Our swimmer from Williston. Now, most of you don't know this. In fact, even a lot of our classmates didn't know this, Jim is a diabetic. He's been a diabetic since he was 12 years old. And I can remember he'd have his good days and his bad days. And when he'd sort of get out of adjustment, I mean, he wasn't good for anything. And then he'd snap back. And back in the pool, he would be just as serious as he could ever be. When you're in prep school, you always have a hero, whether it's Superman or Spider-Man or James Bond. And I will tell you, for those of us who were on the swimming team, we had our hero, our own teammate, Jim Edwards, because he was so good and he excelled so much at the sport. He was really an inspiration for us all. There was never any hope that we could ever catch up to him. That was just out of the question. But he was there as an inspiration for all of us. And I remember, of course, the swimming teams during that era were legendary, and the 2 years that we swam together, 63, 64, 64, 65, we won the New England Championships, which so many teams before us and so many teams after us did. And it never was easy. It always came down to the last event or the last thing that could happen to determine the outcome. And our legendary coach, Wilmot Babcock, of course, was a very, very serious man, and he was never accustomed to losing. And I can remember at the championships at Deerfield in 1964, we were behind, and I would say seriously behind. And in order for us to win the meet, which we ultimately did, Williston had to win the final relay, and it qualified only 3rd behind Andover and, yes, Deerfield. And Jim wasn't in the relay, but he came to the members of the team who were in the relay, and he said, "I've never had the confidence in a team that I have in this one." So we looked at one another. We said, "He's never let us down. We can't let him down." And of course, we ended up beating Deerfield and Andover, and we took home the bacon. So I would like to introduce one of the finest swimmers in the world and my hero, Jim Edwards.
Gee, it matches my tie. How about that? I don't want to take much of your time. I do want to tell you a few things about, not about me necessarily, but about the gifts I got when I came to the school. I was at a school in Podunk, Manchester, New Hampshire. Now, it was a high school, public high school. The high school was losing its accreditation. My fears were two. That one, I might graduate, and two, if I did, I'd go to UNH only. But I just started swimming when I was 15, and I said to myself, I need more than that. So what my father and I did was take a trip to Williams College, and we sat with the coach. And the coach said, Jim, with this high school and these grades you've gotten, you need to get into a prep school and probably do a PGD year there and go from there. And we thought about it, and he said, and by the way, I want you to go visit Philip Stevens and Wilmont S. Babcock at Williston. So we did. Next thing I knew, we were in the office of Philip Stevens talking to him. I met Babs, and I said, this is it. We're going to go here. And I did. And I have not looked back with any regrets whatsoever over those 2 years. Let me check my notes here. So, I lived in Campbell House for 2 years, right across the hall from David Beebe, with a bunch of other athletes in there. Had a great time. But why did I live there? It was a single room. We could study. And I didn't have the distraction that I always had in a high school of girls, because obviously we were just a men's school back then. I worked in Ford Hall in the cafeteria. I did this for two reasons. One, I could maintain my strict diet, which I couldn't necessarily maintain at the long tables that were out there. Boy, are they lucky now from where they eat. Oh. Anyway, and two, I could depend upon Alphonse back there to help me maintain my diet with the diabetes, which was very important to me. I have four vignettes to talk to you about. The vignettes deal with people who affected me very positively and taught me an awful lot at Williston. And I wouldn't be very surprised if other folks didn't learn some of the same heartfelt lessons that I did. First guy was Tom Kelly. Tom Kelly was my English teacher. Now, among other things, and this was during my first year, among other things, we learned how to do extemporaneous talking, speeches. And we would be in the Dodge Room for these specific lessons that he had, and we would get in front of the podium, like so, and pick something from a hat, a subject matter. And the challenge was, talk for 5 minutes on what you have there in front of you. What did that teach me? That taught me, among other things, the unplanned imaginative thinking and expression of self, which I hadn't had before. I walked out of there with that confidence that he gave me or allowed me to gain. Next vignette, Ray Brown, my physics teacher. I came here with a big target on my head that said, ringer. And immediately what I thought was, okay, ringer, that means I'm not very smart. I can't really do anything but jump in the pool. And didn't leave me feeling very well about myself. And I said, what am I going to really learn from this guy? Show people who you really are through your actions, is what he taught me. Show people what you really are through your actions. Another vignette, Rick Francis. Now, back in those days, Rick Francis was an ex-college quarterback. Had an arm on him, unbelievable. In the fall, I played soccer, so I'd go by the field where they were practicing football, and I watched him throw that football 70 yards. And I shook my head and I said, I can't even believe that. If we've got professors, teachers like that here, I better step up my game. Inspiration. Now, I spent more time with my first real coach, swimming coach, than with anybody else up to that point in time in my life, with Wilmont S. Babcock. Tremendous fella, just a tremendous fella. Learned a bunch from him. Humility, self-confidence, team support, which was absolutely needed for everybody, and what can be accomplished through an approving smile. When he smiled, folks, his face would light up, it'd get cherub-like, and it would be red, and it was to die for. You wanted that. So I walked away with really four learnings from these four people. Confidence building, effort, inspiration, and humility and hard work. And oh, by the way, Ray, I got second honors my second year. So I wasn't empty. I graduated and was accepted at UNC in Chapel Hill, where I attended 4 years and swam all 4 years. What's really interesting, by the way, there were 18 All-American high school athletes in our freshman class. We were so stacked and loaded with talent that we were the best one in the country at the time. What really is significant for me in my career in swimming are the 2 years I was here and the 1 year that I was, my first year at UNC, which were my best years in swimming in my entire career, due to one thing, and that was the diabetes. But I want to tell you, I wouldn't have traded it for the world. I would come back here in a New York minute and do the same thing over again because it was worthwhile. Now, after graduating from UNC, I went on to get my MBA at the Thunderbird Graduate School of International Management in Phoenix, or Glendale, Arizona. And I want to leave with you just a couple of thoughts. I am most proud in all of this world and all these years I've lived to have my wife, Maggie, of 37 years, to have my children, Andrea, my daughter, my son, John, the entrepreneur, and Joseph, my grandson, who is my brown belt in karate guy at 7.5 years old. The other thing I'm very proud of is the fact that I'm still alive after having diabetes for 56 years, and I was recognized by the Joslin Clinic in Boston for having had it when I had it for 50 years. So with that, I want to thank Jeff's committee. I appreciate very much the honor. I want to thank my fellow inductees. I want to thank this big guy for helping me out, because I hate talking about myself. And I want to thank all of you. We have every right to be happy that we're here. Thanks.
Thank you, Jim, and congratulations. And if the offer is still there, you're welcome to come back and swim for me anytime you want. Jeff tells me we're only a few minutes over schedule, so that's a win as well. Our final inductee is one of the greatest female athletes to ever attend Williston, Northampton. I would like to invite the newly married Katie Coffey, as well as her brother Michael, class of 2002, and sister Kelly, class of 2007, to join us on stage now, please.
Good afternoon, everyone. Last ones here. It's really an honor to share in this special event, and I'd like to congratulate all the other inductees. It's been amazing to hear some of these incredible accomplishments. My sister Kelly and I have the honor tonight of introducing our sister and newly married Katie Coffey Pajuco. Williston has been a very special place for our family and the scene of many great memories over the years. My grandfather, John Foley, attended Williston for a year in 1946, and thanks to my parents, my two sisters and I were fortunate enough to attend both the middle school and high school spanning 1996 to 2007. So in preparation for tonight, we took many walks down memory lane and actually stumbled upon an article from the Willistonian, the school newspaper, that was an athletic profile of our family, obviously driven by the accolades of Katie. In that article, Katie was described as a silent leader. I will have to be honest with you, we all got a very good laugh out of that, because for those who know her, Katie Coffey is by no means silent. But the article did go on to accurately quote her Williston soccer coach, Jeff Pilgrim, describing Katie's strengths as pretty much including everything. Katie was not only a tremendous athlete, but was a great student, teammate, and sister. But perhaps one of her best traits is her modesty. So let me very quickly turn the microphone over to my sister, Kelly, to allow her to list a few of Katie's numerous athletic accomplishments, which Katie would otherwise never tell you.
Thank you, Mike. Not only am I lucky enough to call Katie my sister, but I was fortunate enough to have Katie as my teammate for 3 years in both soccer and basketball at Williston, so I can attest firsthand to athletic prowess. Katie was a 16-year, three-sport varsity letter holder with six varsity soccer letters, six varsity basketball letters, and four track and field letters. In soccer, Katie was an All-American, a Scholar All-American, the 2003 Massachusetts Player of the Year, a three-time member of the All-New England soccer team, a four-time member of the All-State soccer team, and a five-time member of the All-League team. She was also a two-year co-captain and also held and or holds numerous records, including the goal-scoring record and the points leader. Her most prized memory, though, was being the team member of the 2002 New England Prep School co-champions and the 2003 champions. In basketball, she was a two-year co-captain and one-time all-league team member. In track and field, she was a gold medalist in the 200-meter dash at the New England Track Championships and previously held school records in the 100-meter and 200-meter dash. These are just to name a few of her many accomplishments. Katie then went on to a strong collegiate soccer career, beginning at Boston College and then at Amherst College. With that, I would like to present our sister, Katie Coffey Pajuco.
Thank you, Mike and Kelly. I'm extremely humbled by that wonderful introduction. Wow, I've had one of the best months of my life. I just married the man of my dreams, who is here with me today, and now this. I am incredibly honored to be here today at a place where I spent 6 years and hold dearly in my heart. To me, Williston sports were so much more than a hobby and a competition. They connected me with amazing people and created lifelong friendships. As a matter of fact, three of my Williston teammates were recently in my wedding this past May. I still remember the first day of soccer preseason in seventh grade, showing up with my large mom-made water bottle, big bangs, and braces. I caught a ride with a senior to the first practice, huge butterflies in my stomach. It was pretty intimidating to be playing alongside about a dozen seniors and PGs that year. From the onset, though, the upperclassmen took me under their wings and made me feel right at home. This was pretty much how my entire Williston experience went. I had such encouragement and support from my teachers, my coaches, my friends, and my family who helped me grow and shape who I am today. As much as I cherish this award, I cherish even more the memories and people that led me here. My hardworking parents who gifted me with this esteemed education, my siblings, Mike and Kelly, who always had my back. My four grandparents, one of whom I am lucky to have with me here today, and one who did a PG year at Williston himself, who cheered me on at the majority of my games and events. My teammates, my track relay teams, my coaches, specifically Pill, Ray Brown, Whip, Ms. Seymour, Mr. McDonald, and Al Shaler, and my teachers, who were also engaged with my activities and could always be seen on the sidelines. Thank you specifically to Pill, who helped to change how prep school soccer was viewed in the eyes of the nation. Thank you to him for putting us on the same playing field as the public schools in the National Soccer Association's eyes. Lastly, I would like to give a special mention to my dad, who has coached me in sports since I was 3 years old. He taught me just as much off the field as he did on the field, to work hard, always stay humble, know my roots, and to believe in myself. I truly feel blessed for the opportunity to have had Williston's influence on my life. I may have only been here for 6 years, but the influence and memories from that time frame will certainly last a lifetime. Thank you. And one last comment. I laugh when I heard about some of Ray Brown's sayings, because one of the things I always say and remember is, son of a biscuit.
All right, first of all, congratulations to all inductees. Let's have another round of applause for them. I'd also like to thank my wife, who is the lovely Vanna White over here. For those of you who are interested, we'll be showing the running of the Belmont Stakes down the Stubop, I believe at the 6:40 post time. Hopefully we have a triple round, crown winner. In addition, class photos will begin behind us on the International Terrace, so please listen for your class to be called. We'll also be posting the times here. Now, I don't know about you, I'm parched, so bars are open in the back. Please enjoy yourself and have a great night. Thank you.